Hi, I'm Daniel Köhn from the Institute of Geoscience at Christian Albrechts University Kiel. Welcome to my talk. Today I want to show you how we can improve the robustness of the classical full waveform inversion approach by randomly mixing different objective functions during the iterative local optimization stage of full waveform inversion. I assume most listeners are familiar with the general concept of waveform inversion. You can estimate a high-resolution model of the subsurface by minimizing the misfit between synthetic and field data. One key ingredient for a successful waveform inversion is the choice of the objective function, which is a measure for the data misfit. When the waveform inversion was introduced in the 1980s by Tarantola and his PhD students, they generally relied on the L2 norm of the data residuals. So you simply take the square of the data residuals of each sample in your data set and then simply sum over all of them. On the pro side, this objective function is very easy to implement. On the con side, it is very sensitive to amplitude variations, which becomes an issue as soon as you want to apply the waveform inversion to a field data set. In order to increase the robustness of the waveform inversion, especially if you want to invert near-surface data with dominant surface waves, hierarchical waveform inversion workflows have been developed, where we first use objective functions which strongly focus on the phase information, for example misfit functions in the FK domain or using the envelope of the data residuals. And after fitting the phase information, we can then fit in an additional stage the amplitude information using the L2 norm of the data residual. In 2020, Judy Pan, Lingli Gao, and Renat Shigapov from the Karlsruhe Institute of Technology published a series of papers where they randomly mixed misfit functions with different phase and amplitude weights. My first reaction to these papers was, that is a very stupid idea. Why would you sacrifice the robustness of the hierarchical phase and amplitude waveform inversion? However, after a longer discussion with my girlfriend, she convinced me why this random mixing of objective function is actually a very good idea. By the way, a small pro tip, always listen to your girl/boyfriend to get a new perspective on a complicated problem. So thank you for that. So why might it be a bad idea to first invert for phase and later for amplitude information? Well, very simple. By completely ignoring the amplitude information, your inversion can run into a local minimum. The same issue can occur when you apply time or offset windows to your data, or more generally, every time you ignore certain properties of your data. The random objective waveform inversion used by Pan, Gao, and Shigapov was specifically designed to invert surface waves. However, we wanted to invert a reflection seismic data set with very weak reflection events and a very bad signal-to-noise ratio, so we had to use slightly different objective functions. So to enhance the reflected wave field, we used an AGC-weighted L2 norm as objective function, which is actually a very bad idea because it completely destroys the amplitude information, leading to systematic over- and underestimations of the inverted model parameters. In order to compensate for the missing amplitudes, we randomly mixed the AGC norm with the normalized L2 norm. So this is our reflection-focused random objective waveform inversion approach. Let's test this approach for a synthetic test problem, the well-known Marmoussi II model, which covers different degrees of geological complexity, from simple 1D layers to complex systems of thrust folds. As initial model for the inversion, we assumed a 1D P-wave velocity model. Using a waveform inversion with the steepest descent optimization approach and the classical L2 norm, we can recover most of the features in the model, even within the complex thrust fold system, as you can see when I switch between the inversion result and the true model. When applying the reflection focus random objective waveform inversion, we get essentially the same result, as you can see here at the bottom. So far, so unspectacular. Keep in mind, though, that the objective function is randomly changed from one iteration to the next. What happens if we run the ROV multiple times? Again, and again, and again, and again. Notice how the upper parts of the model remain more or less the same for the different ROV runs. However, in the deeper parts, you can see differences in the inversion results from one ROV to the next. The reason for that is that the stochastic gradients updates leads to slightly different paths through the parameter space. Now, from the 5 different ROV runs, we can calculate an average p-wave velocity model and the standard deviation. The standard deviation is quite interesting because it summarizes very effectively which parts of the model are sensitive to the ROV updates and which deliver stable inversion results. Generally, the upper parts show smaller standard deviations than the deeper parts. Notice also that the larger deviations occur at the layer interfaces, which cannot perfectly be reconstructed due to the band limitations of the source signal. Let's try another interesting comparison. On the top, I computed the standard deviation of the averaged ROV model from the true model and compared with the standard deviation from the 5 ROV runs. Of course, this is an apple to oranges comparison, as you can see already in the amplitudes of the different deviations. The standard deviations from the ROV runs are very small near the left and right model boundaries, as you can see here and here. The reason for this is that the model updates are limited by the finite size of the acquisition geometry. Therefore, it cannot represent the large derivations from the true model, as you can see over here. So we cannot compute from the standard deviation of the ROV runs the large deviations between the average p-wave velocity model and the true model here at the boundaries. However, what's interesting, in the central part of the model, both standard deviations show similar trends, and that is that the layer interfaces cannot be accurately reconstructed. So this is very similar in both standard deviations. So after the synthetic tests with the Mamusi 2 model, we applied the reflection-focused ROV to a field data set acquired in spring 2019 at the southern coast of the Eckernförder Bay in northern Germany. The Applied Geophysics group from the Institute of Geoscience at Christian Albrechts University Kiel measured 2 seismic profiles, one using a massive vibrosize truck, the other with a weight drop. In this study, I want to focus on the 2 kilometer long beach profile that you can see over here. The purpose of the seismic surveys was the mapping of a complex fault system associated with salt tectonics in the Glückstadtgraben. This was already investigated quite extensively in a previous study based on classical reflection seismic. So if you're interested in the detail, I've given here the reference to this paper. The new surveys were specifically designed to apply a seismic waveform inversion. The initial model for the acoustic waveform inversion was derived by classical reflection seismic velocity analysis. In the top 350 meter, it basically shows a velocity increase from 1600 to 2000 meters per second in the p-wave velocity. Applying the classical for waveform inversion using a trace normalized L2 norm as objective function leads to this result. At first you might think that result is quite reasonable. There are some layers and a certain amount of chaotic complexity, which would not be really surprising for a thrust fault system. However, looking more closely, we noticed, for example, this high velocity layer in the first 100 meters, which seemed to be not really consistent with our initial model. And as we will see later on, it will also be not really consistent with the result of the classical reflection seismic imaging. This high velocity layer vanishes when applying the reflection focused random objective waveform inversion, and overall the inversion result becomes much less chaotic. Instead, we can now easily distinguish between the area of the perturbated subsurface here at the center and at the left within the Glückstadtgraben and, let's say, less perturbated parts of the model outside of the graben here at the right of the model. So very distinct difference between the structures within the graben and outside. Next, we compared the random objective waveform inversion with the classical reflection seismic image and its interpretation. Now, if I switch between the reflection seismic image and the ROV result, you can recognize many similarities in terms of the locations of the layer interfaces and the positions of the thrust faults of the seismic interpretation. Most importantly, we do not see the dominant near-surface high-velocity layer from the classical waveform inversion approach in the reflection seismic image. So therefore, we are very confident that the reflection-focused random objective waveform inversion result produced a subsurface model which is a better representation of the physical and geological properties of the complex thrust fault system within the Glückstadtgraben than the classical waveform inversion. So finally, I want to thank the usual suspects for their financial support, the Computing Center at Kiel University, and finally you for your attention. Thank you very much.